The hellbender is North America's largest salamander. It's an ancient amphibian dating back about 160 million years, for which it's remained relatively unchanged. It's a fully aquatic salamander, living most of its entire life underwater, from an egg to a larvae, a juvenile, as well as an adult. It's a long-lived amphibian. It's been documented to live over 30 years in the wild.
They can be very slimy. They're actually very strong, muscular.
The hellbender as an adult can reach up to 2 feet in length, and they eat mainly crayfish, and they need cool, clean, clear, rocky streams.
It's one of those animals that has such unique characteristics that, for whatever reason, people generate their own nicknames for it, whether that's calling it a water dog or a devil dog or a snot otter is one of the names that people come up with.
Indiana, like many other states, have been monitoring the hellbender populations over time. And what we discovered is that populations are unfortunately in decline. What this has done is prompted an extensive collaboration among various agencies, including university faculty and staff, state and federal agencies, zoos, the Nature Conservancy, and of course, private citizens throughout the watershed.
The Department of Natural Resources looks for people to help them conserve endangered species, to learn about enough information to manage them.
The Department of Natural Resources started surveying for hellbenders back in 1998. They set up 12 different locations that we survey about every year. Mainly we're going out and flipping over large rocks, looking for good habitats that they may need to be under. The hellbender likes to have large flat rocks, mainly for nesting and protection.
We all need habitat. Habitat, I think, is broken down into three easy to understand things. We all need a place to live, we all need shelter, a place to hide, a place to sleep, we all need food to eat, and we all need air to breathe, or in this case, good water to drink. And so just as we need those things, the hellbender needs those things also. In the case of a river, we know whether those things are good or not by how many hellbenders we've got. If the hellbender population is declining, then we're concerned that something's wrong with one of those three things.
There are several conservation strategies that many states are implementing across the range to try to reverse the declines that we're seeing in hellbender populations. One of those is captive propagation. And captive propagation is essentially removing eggs from the wild, taking those eggs to a zoo or a university or a fish hatchery, and rearing those until they hatch into larvae. They then rear those larvae for a couple of years to ultimately release those back out into the wild.
We went to the Dallas-Fort Worth Zoo and actually collected 18 juvenile eastern hellbenders, which were actually reared from a egg mass from the wild out of West Virginia. They ran out of room there at their facilities, so they gave it to Dallas-Fort Worth Zoo, where we then had to drive out, collect these individuals, bring them back to Purdue, and we've been rearing them for a year and a half.
We are in an environmental chamber at the Purdue's Aquatic Research Laboratory. So we've got 10 tanks. Each of them have a set of hellbenders in them. When we first started, we didn't have these rocks in here, and so it was pretty bare, and we mostly made sure that the water was clean, kept them fed, and kept record of their health, to make sure nothing was out of place, or make sure they looked healthy and happy, and that they had been eating. But now, we've been working to add in some more environmental factors, like these rocks.
For these surgical procedures, I had to implant a radio transmitter into their body cavity, and through that, I'm able to track the animals' movements throughout the Blue River. The main goal and purpose behind doing this is to determine whether or not moving hellbenders throughout the river can be a good method used for future purposes.
Questions regarding which animals to move and where to move them are oftentimes best answered using genetics. This requires a lot of field work, it requires a lot of collaboration, and it requires a lot of lab work.
Essentially, out in the field, they're collecting the individuals and taking a small tissue clip to have here and to bring back in the genetics lab. And then once we get that tissue clip back here, we'll extract the DNA, and then we'll actually look at that DNA and how it compares across the whole range, how populations are differentiated, how individuals are within populations, looking at overall genetic diversity, because it's important to document these levels of genetic diversity that remain in the wild as these populations become more and more increasingly fragmented and isolated. It's important to sort of, from a genetics perspective, be able to look at these population declines and what genetic stock remains in nature.
My part of the project is to bring the eggs that we find in the Blue River back here, put this in this apparatus called a heath tray, and then raise them until they're a year or two old, and then we'll re-release them back into the wild. Basically what it does is the water wells up, the eggs and larvae are sort of sandwiched in there between two layers of screen, and the upwelling water keeps them from touching each other, and it keeps them off of the bottom. And this really reduces infection and disease transmission.
As states begin implementing conservation strategies that actually increase local densities of hellbenders, that also increases the likelihood that people are going to come into contact with this animal. That automatically raises questions for people. What is this animal? What do we do with it? Who do we notify? So one of the things that we're focused on is increasing public awareness. And we're fortunate to be able to partner with experts in our social science department to address questions and give us information on how we should go about this.
My role is to understand the human dimensions of the hellbender. So it's, well, we're here putting them back in the river and trying to protect the population. How do we keep them in the river? We have to understand people and make sure that people know what to do if they catch one, make sure people know that they need to keep the water clean.
The people in this community really love the natural resources. They love the river, they love the woods, you know, they love the caves. And so I think part of our efforts with the hellbender are trying to tie some of that appreciation and stewardship of the local natural resources to extend out to the hellbender.
We have created a website through Purdue, HELPthehellbender.org, and that has resources for all sorts of different outreaches. So there's teachers and there's websites for lesson plans and things to do to try to bring hellbenders in the classroom. There's also things for homeowners, what homeowners can do, like add rain barrels and help with the water quality. There's also things for anglers, so if they catch a hellbender, what do you do? We want you just to cut the line. Just things for every sort that people can help in their own way. The hellbenders don't have a voice, and we are their voice, so it's really important to me to help the public understand this special creature that we all have near to our home.
What I hope is that in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, as they're doing this, as the Indiana DNR continues to do surveys in the Blue River, they'll start to see the numbers start to rebound. And they'll start to see some of those younger age classes and some natural reproduction that doesn't require us to intervene.
As a scientist, a day like today where we're releasing some juveniles to the stream is a great joy to me, because it means we're making positive steps in order to try to restore these animals. And I think that we are catching them just in time, and we have a great possibility of success.
One of the most rewarding portions of this project for me are all the collaborations that stem from the various research projects. We're all working very, very hard to preserve this living fossil.